Perfect. So, hi everybody. My name is Kai from Confluent, and I want to give you today about an introduction about Apache Kafka's event-driven open source streaming platform. And who of you is using Apache Kafka already? Okay, it's maybe around 50% or so. And also for all the others, in the end, the goal of this session is really to show you the complete Kafka ecosystem and what it's used for. Because one of the key messages of this talk is really that Kafka is much more than just a scalable messaging system for data ingestion into Hadoop or other big data stores. But actually, we right now see 80% or so of the projects which are not really about big data like terabytes or petabytes, but about smaller data for things like mission-critical applications, for payments or fraud detection, and many other scenarios. So big data streaming, that's just one part of what Apache Kafka is used for today. And therefore, that's in the end the overview I want to give you today in the next 45 minutes or so. And I always start with this picture, which is more or less the real world in most bigger companies today, where you have a lot of applications, some legacy, some modern ones, some hype technologies. You have different concepts like request response, real-time, batch processing, all of that, and they have to work together. And so now, with Apache Kafka, we see the same picture like we saw it with many other technologies before. Like every enterprise service bus vendor or every ETL vendor shows the same picture. Here's the black box in the middle, and now you can integrate everything. And so the difference with Kafka, and that's in the end what I want to show you today, and why so many use Kafka here as streaming platform in the middle between the different applications, no matter if it's batch, if it's real-time, if it's different things combined, and why Kafka works so well here and why it scales well in these areas and for these kind of projects. And then really many companies in the meantime use it more as central nervous system between all the different components. So while this is more a high level overview without too much technology deep dive, there's also another talk later by Guido Schmitz who is going a little bit deeper into other technology components. So there's not much overlap, and I really recommend to go into both parts of both sessions. So this is the main motivation in the end, and why do so many people use Kafka and all the components around that? The main idea is really that people actually, they think about data flows, but they build it today with data stores, which is not really a good idea. Because if we think about one example here, like retail, but it's true in any industry. So if in retail, if there's happens something like you do a booking for anything, for a shop order in Amazon or for a bed in Airbnb, then you click on a button and some processes happen. And in most companies today, at least in the traditional ones, which exist for longer than, let's say, 5 to 10 years, you store it in a database, and then the next one gets it, and then you do fraud detection the next day. And then after that, you have found out, oh, this was fraud, but then it is too late already because the fraud already happened. And so what you want to do instead is you continuously want to process the data and see it as data flow. And that's in the end where Kafka comes in the middle very, very often. So let's take a specific example of Airbnb. So here, if you reserve a new room in the mobile app, then this creates an event. So all of this is event-based. And this event is distributed via Kafka to many other systems. And these other systems can be anything. So this can be the real-time payment system or the real-time fraud detection system. But this can also be, for example, a batch processing system like Hadoop, which processes it only overnight. For example, it analyzes all the bookings of the last week to find out what's going on, where is a lot of bookings happening, these kind of things, or find other insights. That's more or less the general use case, and Kafka is the decoupling system in the middle. It's still very scalable and so on, but it's also decoupling all the different components. And that's a huge advantage, especially if you talk about these buzzwords like microservices and so on, where you want to build independent services or application, or even if it's independent monoliths. They have to communicate with each other, but need to be independent from each other for building new versions, for testing, for version testing and so on. So that's very important that they are decoupled, and that's where Kafka is very different from other integration solutions or other messaging systems, for example. So we are going away from thinking about databases. Do not store everything statically in a database where someone else can get it from. You pull it again after 10 seconds, after an hour, after a day, or whenever. So the thinking of Kafka is really that you think in streams. And under the hood of streams, that's in the end events. So here you come to all these concepts about event sourcing and other patterns which you hear. But the key is that in the middle, you have in the end a log with events. So you store every single event in this log after each other, and then everybody can consume this log again from the beginning or from where you want or need to start from reading this log. So in the end, you model change explicitly. That's the key difference to a database where you write the updates to an existing state. You model change explicitly in new events. It's all event-based driven architectures. And with that, now, and that's also why we talk about a streaming platform. It's much more than just messaging in the middle. You really can message and your storage and process the data in Kafka. And then you can integrate with any kind of systems. So it's not just, as I said, for things like Hadoop or Spark, the big data stuff. This is one scenario where you push data to. But it's also for many other kind of systems, like legacy applications. We have so many customers, especially banks and insurance companies, which use Kafka to get data out of the mainframes. You offload the mainframe data and push it into Kafka to get it from there as an event-based concept into new applications like a web application, a mobile app, or anything else. And another advantage is, for example, to reduce cost in the mainframe story. So you can combine all the different applications around Kafka in the middle. And so let's now think about the concepts of Kafka and the technology behind that. And why is more or less the de facto standard for these kind of use cases and is used in almost every company in the meantime over the world. So the key difference is, and that's really the key important point, that Kafka is much more than just messaging. Yes, as you see here, number one, publish, subscribe. Kafka is a messaging system. But number two, it's also distributed storage under the hood, where you can store the data as long as you want, in a scalable and also in a fault-tolerant way. And then also, if you want to, you can process the data on Kafka. So this is the three components of Kafka Core, the core components. There's a lot around that, which I will talk about later in the talk. But first, let's talk about the basic concepts of core Kafka. And so let's begin with the first one, messaging. That's what everybody knows Kafka about. It scales very well, and you can process millions or billions of messages. That's true, and that's important. So let's start with this. So the central abstraction, and that's already also very important in Kafka. In databases, we talk about tables. In Hadoop, we talk about files. And what about messaging now? So the first very important difference, we are not talking about a queue in Kafka. That's one of the key fundamental differences to traditional messaging systems. In a queuing system, you send a message to the queue, and someone consumes it, and then it's gone. Right, it's not longer in the queue, and therefore it's a problem for many systems and for many use cases. Like you get back pressure, so the producers cannot produce anymore because the queue cannot handle it, or some consumer is off for some time and so he loses some messages and all these things. So what we talk about is, in Kafka terms, it's a topic instead of a queue. But even more important than the concept is the concept under the hood. So you have a commit log, a distributed commit log. That means every message or every event gets into Kafka. Here you see beginning by zero, and every message is added as immutable log information. And then the producers can produce messages here, and then the readers, which are the consumers, they can consume the messages. But they can consume the message in their pace. So one consumer is batch, it can consume every message overnight in 1 hour. Another one is a millisecond fraud detection system, and another one is maybe request response via REST, which accesses the data, right? And so different readers or consumers can consume all the data from Kafka, or the data they want to consume, in the pace they want to do, and as often as they want to. And that's a key difference to traditional messaging with queues. And that's one of the most important concepts and differences you have to understand in comparison why so many people use Kafka. Especially if you think about microservice architectures with decoupling of different systems. That's much, much easier with Kafka and logs. Because with queuing, we have to build a lot of features around that, which are in Kafka out of the box. So the idea is, with Kafka, you have many different apps which produce data. In this case, it's just two, but it can also be hundreds or so. So really, we see companies which have Kafka as central nervous system, where hundreds of producers and consumers communicate with one Kafka cluster. And on the other side, you consume the data. That's the second part. And here again, we see different apps which consume the data in their pace. Some in batch, some in real time, some in near real time, some via request response. Whatever is okay for your application, it's independent of all the others one. It's loosely coupled with Kafka in the middle. And then also, not just Kafka is scalable, but also the consumers here. So there's a concept-based consumer groups. So you can also dynamically add or remove consumers from that group. So you can scale it up and down. Back to the retailer example in the beginning. Before Christmas, typical vendors like Airbnb or Amazon, they simply scale up the consumer groups so that they can process more orders which are coming in. Right, so you can scale it up and down, either statically or dynamically. And then Kafka scales with that. That's the huge also difference to traditional queuing systems. So with this, this is getting now closer to a streaming platform. We do much more than just messaging with that. And for that also, Apache Kafka, the open source project, like you downloaded from the Apache website, has another component for connecting to different systems. That is called Kafka Connect, and this integrates with many different systems, both for sources like a database or like sync systems like AWS H3 or Elasticsearch and many, many others. And with these you can easily integrate with all the other systems. The huge benefit of Kafka Connect is that it's built on Kafka. So all the scalability and failover and message throughput you have in Kafka, you have the same for Kafka Connect. And with that, you can easily integrate with existing systems, both on the legacy side, even with mainframes and these kind of things, or on the other side with the modern technologies like an Hadoop or Spark or Elasticsearch or any other application. So that's the huge advantage of Kafka Connect, and therefore, if there is an adapter available, it doesn't make much sense to build your own in this case, because then you have to cover these things, like how to scale up and down, how to do fault tolerance, and how to manage the schema of the message and these kind of things. That's included into Kafka Connect as part of Apache Kafka. So here's one example, and that's typically how it starts. So in this case, we have just one JDBC data source. In this case, we're using a pull mechanism to read the data from the database. You could also use change data capture to push the data for every event into Kafka. No matter how that works, how you get the data into Kafka, in Kafka it gets into events. So from here you have the event-driven design, so that you process each event by itself. So then you have it in Kafka via Kafka Connect. And as next step, you add additional databases. So the scalability is built into Kafka Connect. So even if you add more and more resources to that. And also the Connect instances can be scaled. So here we see just three. You can easily scale it up to 5 or 10 or how many you need there. And then on the other side, we have the sync, where you do the same. You have connectors where you push data into another system. And this is what we see often as first, you have things like Hadoop, you push every data into Hadoop to analyze it there further. But then as soon as you have set up Kafka in your company, many other departments or projects find out, well, I also want to get some of the data, and can I also connect to this? And then here we see the huge benefit of Kafka in this decoupling, because you do not have to set up new queues or think about how to scale this with many new consumers. You simply add other consumer groups. And a consumer can be anything. It can be a Java or .NET or Go or Python application if you write something by yourself. Or it can be a database like MySQL or S3. It can be a big data cluster like Hadoop or Spark. It can be anything. And all of them can consume the data they want from Kafka in the pace they want and how often they want. For example, we see more and more use cases where customers also use Kafka for machine learning, where you build many different models. Either with one technology, so build 10 models just with TensorFlow, or evaluate different frameworks like TensorFlow and H2O and Deep Learning 4J, all get the same data out of Kafka to use the same events as input to build their model, one or more. And then you can decide which one is the best. And 1 week later, you can do the same with the same data if you still store it in Kafka. So that's the main concept first. So this is really about messaging and integration. This is the part of Kafka. And also very important, besides this messaging part, to get system to get information from A via Kafka to B and to D. So the next important thing is it's not just messaging, it's also storage, right? And so if you think about why storing, we just want to do messaging with Kafka. So the answer is pretty easy. In the end, every messaging system is a storage system, because the consumer might be down or might not be able to process it at that speed. You have to think about somehow how to store it there. And also for things like failover, right? You have to think about if my queue or what goes down, how do you scale it up so that you can still consume it and do not lose messages. So you have to store it, and Kafka does this in a very smart way so that you can also support different consumers, slow consumers, or reprocess. In the case, for example, of machine learning, where you build different models, or in other examples where you simply have a new version of a new microservice which wants to start from the beginning from all data and start with that, and then you consume from zero to get all data again into the system. So there's many different arguments, and the key now with Kafka and why this works so well, because it's not working like a file like a messaging system here, because messaging systems don't really scale well. I mean, yes, you have a failover system, so you have one queue and then you have a backup queue, which is passive, and then if the active queue goes down, you switch over to the passive queue. But this does not work well for scale or flexibility if you want to dynamically add new consumers and new nodes. And Kafka is very smart here, and therefore you can read about the tech giants like Netflix, like LinkedIn, like Uber, who process petabytes of data per day, so really petabytes. That's just the example, so which makes it pretty easy. So Our customers don't worry about the scalability and about the throughput and failover and all these things. That's battle-tested by the tech giants, and 99% of all other companies will not have this traffic or these challenges. So this is battle-tested and works. You just have to think about how that works in your use cases and how you build that into your applications. That's the challenges we see in the projects around Kafka. And with that on the other side, yes, it's a distributed file system, but still you get the guarantees, like you know it a little bit from a database, things like strict ordering or persistence, so that you can guarantee things like failover, right? So it's distributed by design, so it's expected that things fail. That's a difference to the queuing system where you actually want that queues run for 100%, because then if it's failover, it's a lot of problems in the applications and also doesn't scale well. And Kafka by design is built for replication. So you typically have a replication factor of 2 or 3 so that we replicate to different brokers so that a message or even is stored more than once. And if a node goes down, it simply can also get it from the other one. And all this failover and handling and consumer failover, this is all built into Kafka, so you don't have to care about that. And that's true for both the broker, where the messages are stored and distributed, but also for the consumer side. So if you have 10 consumers and 1 or 2 go down for whatever reason, no network, the disk is down or whatever, then it's only consumed by the other 8 consumers. But Kafka manages that for you in the client application. You do not have to cover that in the implementation. And that makes it for you much easier to build a scalable application or microservice and focus on the business logic and deploy that. And that's the huge advantages of Kafka and the very different thing compared to traditional messaging or other integration solutions based on top of messaging. So the next part then is this was the storage part. That's the key core Kafka. It's messaging plus distributed storage. That's what Kafka is, right? And in addition to that, we also want to process data on top of Kafka. So now, why do you want to do that? That's simply more or less optional. You don't have to do it. So you can just integrate between A and B and C. But you also, if you are on Kafka anyway for the infrastructure, then you could also process data here. And why do so many customers do that in the meantime with a streaming platform, which means really stream processing, which again means process an event continuously while the data is in motion without storing it to a database first. No push, no request response, not storing for an hour, for 10 minutes, for 10 seconds. You continuously process the data while it is in motion. That's the idea behind stream processing. And so for stream processing, we know a lot of frameworks. What we call as the first generation of stream processing, it's actually some kind of faster MapReduce, right? So in the beginning, we had big data sets on top of Hadoop, and we used some kind of MapReduce implementation or a framework like Hive, where we did batch processing to process the data. And then a lot of frameworks came up, which were also running on Hadoop system, and they did some kind of stream processing. But you then process event by event, but you still process it on the big data cluster, right? You have to set up your Spark cluster, or your Storm cluster, or whatever, and process it there. And what you can do as option, I'm not saying it's always the better thing, but sometimes it's an option, is you can also simply build very lightweight, scalable microservices based on top of Kafka. And for that, and again, as part of Apache Kafka project, like you download it from the Apache website, you also have Kafka Streams. Kafka Streams is just a library which you embed into any kind of application. And with that, you can build very lightweight and small applications or microservices to do stream processing. But with all the features like in Spark and Flink, so we do things like aggregations and filtering and transformations and so on. So the key difference is more or less a different deployment model which you have with that. The key advantage is it's built on Kafka, so all the scalability, the failover and so on, that's handled by Kafka under the hood with Kafka topics. So you don't have to worry about that. You just deploy your streaming application with a small application. So what you do with that is then, everyone can focus on his problem. So if you have different projects, like here a payment app, a fraud app, a recommender app, and a monitor app, each one can build small stream processing applications without worrying about where to deploy it in a big cluster and how to merge their resources and manage it so that everybody gets enough resources. You just focus on your part, on your application, and deploy it like you want to do that. That's the key difference compared to the big data cluster stream processing solutions like Flink, Spark Streaming, Storm, or whatever you use there, right? So you don't have to worry about which jobs to start, how to start a job. It's one continuous stream process which you run, and you can scale that up and down independently. And with that, then you can run that where you want. So some still have some legacy Java applications or Java E applications. You can even embed this library into a jar file in a var application, for example. Or if you're a little bit more modern, you can run it in a Docker container or then deploy it to some orchestration framework like Kubernetes or Mesos, or you run it in the cloud, right? So that's doesn't matter. It's just a jar in the end. And that's the different advantage to the big data stream processing frameworks. Under the hood, Kafka Streams is just a char, so it's a Java library. That's very important. It's for the Java platform. And so it's a dependency which you add into your project, into any project, a monolith, a big one, or just a small application which is just one char, the Kafka Streams application then. And you can scale up and down that easily with all the features of Kafka built in. You will hear a lot more about that in the second talk today, where we hear about local state and state stores and these kind of things, which are important, but that's then in the end the next level to discuss on top of that. From a basic perspective, this is really the same operations like you have in other stream processing frameworks. What you want to do, you want to continuously process data. This is simple things like mapping or filtering data before you send it to the next Kafka topic. Or you want to do more powerful things like aggregations. For example, threshold analytics for sensors to find if there is probably an alert that you send an alert to another system. Many different use cases. It's classical stream processing, not different from any other stream processing framework. So it also unifies tables and streams. That's also very important. So one part of Kafka Streams is also the table concept. So if you don't want to, you don't have to use an external database. So you just have local storage on each instance, either just in memory or with RocksDB, which it's using under the hood for a key value store. And with these concepts, you can build very powerful and scalable, but still fault-tolerant, mission-critical microservices, where you still can manage state, even if something goes down, right? So because Kafka Streams does not manage state only local, in a local instance, but also via Kafka again, with Kafka topics. And therefore, even if one node goes down, you don't lose that state of that node. And so the difference, and that's again more or less the motivation why Kafka Stream was built and added to the Apache Kafka project, is that it's much easier to build some parts of stream processing applications. It's not the better one for everything. So if you want to process terabytes of data at once, right, to find things like analytics insights or to do maybe machine learning on everything together and do processing there, then something like Spark or Flink is perfect for that. It's a big data cluster. You send all data there. In 95% of projects with Kafka, so you have the Kafka infrastructure anyway, but then you put it there. But if you want to build real-time streaming applications, like for bank transactions, for payments, for fraud detection, for business use cases, then Kafka Streams is a much easier solution to use, and it also scales in the same way. It's fault-tolerant, but it's pretty easy to use because it's just a char library which you add. And therefore, then, your application looks like this. And you can use that in your project without worrying about deploying something on a big data cluster and worrying that you get your job resources and all these kind of things. It's much easier to think about versioning, about innovation with new features, because you can deploy your service completely independent of everything else. That's the main idea of Kafka Streams. And so with that, you see, this is more or less now Apache Kafka as we see it today and as we see it for many months and a few years already. So if you download Apache Kafka from the Apache website, it already includes Apache Kafka Connect for integration and Kafka Streams for stream processing. That's built into the Apache Kafka project. I point this out very often because many people still are not aware of that and just think about Kafka as only the messaging and storage layer in the middle, which is the key component, of course, but the other ones are also part of the Apache Kafka project and really mature and ready for production. And with that, then, now it also gets clearer why we really talk about a streaming platform with Kafka. It's not just the ingestion between point A and B and C. It's really building mission-critical applications, big ones like monoliths or lightweight ones and flexible ones, around the Kafka ecosystem. And that's here you have so many advantages, like the loosely coupled microservices and still the scalability and the storage all inside of Kafka. So the key difference from Kafka today compared to Kafka maybe 5 years ago is that today you really operate the business with Kafka. It's not just about data ingestion into Hadoop like it was built for 7 years ago. Today, most customers and projects we see, they build mission-critical applications in any industry around Kafka. And therefore, there was a lot of added features around security and compliance things. So in the meantime, it supports all the needed standards like SSL and Kerberos and so on. So banks, even in Germany, run Kafka for mission-critical systems for payments and so on. And if banks and insurance companies can run it from a legal perspective and compliance perspective, then probably everybody can run it easily. So, but that's the main goal of Kafka today, and that's really 80% of the use cases we see today. Still a few big data use cases where you analyze it somewhere in a big data cluster, but that's just one small part of that. And if you have Kafka in the middle, you can do anything around that. So these kind of customers still push it into Hadoop to do the big data processing. But in parallel to that, you can use other consumers to build just small applications which take just parts of the data, which they need for their use case. So with that, this is really the major new ecosystem around Apache Kafka. This is Apache Kafka, the core for messaging and distributed storage. And you have Kafka Connect and you have Kafka Streams. That's the Apache project. So in addition to that, what we as Confluent are building, so we are we have a lot of full-time committers for Kafka itself, so we are contributing a lot there and giving the support for that, but we also build other open source components, which are also Apache 2.0 licensed, the same like Kafka. And in most new projects, we also see many of them used. There is, for example, different clients for other languages, because Kafka is just for the Java platform, but many projects are, for example, Python or Go or .NET, and these are other clients which then produce or consume data from Kafka. And another component is the REST proxy, for example. We also see that a lot. So this simply means that you can then easily communicate with Kafka via HTTP or HTTPS. So the main reason for that is, for example, that you have security requirements that you can only open the HTTP ports to another interface, or you want to make something public to some other companies, or simply because you have a technology which only supports HTTP and REST. So that's then the REST proxy. And also the schema registry is another example. We see that in, I would say, 90% of Kafka projects, especially if it's more than just data ingestion into Hadoop, but really building your mission-critical applications around Kafka, because more or less the schema registry validates the messages, the incoming and outgoing messages about the structure. Is it all correct? Similar to a relational database, if you have a customer with a name, with a street, and with a phone number, that's simply validated with the schema registry. And under the hood, it uses Apache Afro, if you know that, and therefore you have a lot more advantages. So for example, the schema registry also allows you schema evolution. And that means that, for example, a producer sending data to Kafka is still in version 1, and we have two consumers which are also in version 1, and then you need to upgrade the producer to version 2. Let's think about the customer example. We add an email address as next attribute. So the producer has a new attribute, but the both different consumers don't know about that. And hey, we're talking about flexible agile projects and enterprises. Everybody has to innovate quickly, so we cannot migrate everything at once. And even some consumers will not change at all. They will keep at version 1 for the next 5 years because they do not care about an email address, right? And so the schema registry allows the schema evolution. So the producer can send version 2 and it's automatically migrated so the consumers read the versions they understand. So in the beginning, both are version 1, and then one of the consumers might upgrade to version 2 and then it simply changes the configuration. Hey, now give me version 2. And then it will change in this consumer, but not in the other one. And in this way, you can build pretty powerful but still flexible architectures because, again, the applications and services are decoupled from each other. Even if they have different schemas and so on, you can build them independently and version them and innovate and all these things. And that makes Kafka pretty flexible in the middle. So one last thing to talk here before I also go to a live demo is KSQL. KSQL is also an open source project and Apache license we announced, I think, 6 months ago. And this is, in the end, a SQL streaming layer on top of Apache Kafka. So what does that mean? You already see on the picture, in the end, what it means. It's a application which is based on top of Kafka Streams. So it's a stream processing framework where you can all the things you can also do with Kafka Streams and Java code, like things like ETL for transformation or building aggregation windows or any other stream processing applications. But you just write SQL-like code. So it makes it completely different experience to write stream processing with that. And I will also show that a little bit in the live demo. But the key goal really here is not to have something like a select star from customer and then you do an analysis on top of that with a tool like Tableau or Qlik. So the idea is not to do interactive analysis. So it's not a relational database or something like this. The goal is really to build stream processing applications. But with KSQL, you have the option, you don't need to write Java code, but you either use it as more or less analyst or data engineer which wants to do some data preparation and send it to a new topic, or you are a developer in another language like in .NET or Go or Python where Kafka Streams is not available because it's Java, and then you can integrate that KSQL easily from the other technologies. We are a server-side mode so that you have the client in the other technology. So, and the key point here, this is really meant for mission-critical deployments too, like Kafka Streams. And so you can even deploy that in mission-critical systems, even for bank transactions or whatever. And we actually support that. So it was announced half a year ago, and yesterday we made the announcement that in April it will already get GA. And GA means that we as Confluent support that 24/7 for mission-critical systems, like we support all of the other Apache Kafka ecosystem today already. And so that's pretty cool part. And so this was the overview of many of the different components and ecosystem of Kafka. So as you see, it's much, much more than just messaging, with streaming, with integration, with analytics and so on. You can do much more, and most people do in the meantime. And so let's take a look at a short live demo to see how that looks in the real world. I'm just checking. So here I am. You see, hopefully, at the totem pretty good. I will go pretty quick through this to show you some stuff. So, and therefore I will also copy paste instead of writing it by myself. But what I'm doing here, I'm starting from zero. And the first thing I do is I have to start Kafka. When I start Kafka, it always also starts Zookeeper. That's a requirement for most distributed systems today, no matter if it's Hadoop, if it's Mesos, Spark, whatever. They all use Zookeeper as distributed management tool under the hood to manage which instances are up and down and so on. And so what typically you start each one with a batch script, and in this case I use the Confluent open source command line interface where you can do a lot of things, and so it's pretty easy to start different systems and development to get started easily. That's especially for the beginning. For development, it's pretty easy. Here you see, for example, I have now just started Kafka and Zookeeper, but we will integrate any kind of components like KSQL also in the next releases, and you can start and stop them, find the status, find the logs and so on. So that's actually pretty cool. And with that as next step, so what I will do, I will start KSQL, and I will do the not the local mode where everything is started in one instance, but I will do the client server mode. That has the reason that I now can show you different interaction modes. One is the command line interface, and the other one is the web UI. So let's wait while it's starting. It takes a few seconds. And here you see now we have version 0.5, which is the current one. And as I say, the next one is probably the named 1.0, which is the GA release. So with that, we have now the KSQL server. That's in the end, under the hood, it's a Kafka Streams application. This is not the Kafka broker. The Kafka broker, which processes the messages, is still the other component I started first. And KSQL is more or less a producer and consumer. Like any Java app or database, this is just another consumer and producer to the Kafka broker. So what I will do now, I will start the command line interface in another tab, and I will connect to this. So here we are now connecting to the system, and now here we can type our commands. Like the first one we could do is list topics. So here in list topics we see the existing topics. Remember, it's not queues. In Kafka it's topics because it's much more power than a queue. Therefore it's a different name, which makes sense. Right now we don't have much here, in only some default stuff of Kafka KSQL, so we need to create more stuff. But also first let me go to the web UI to show you a different option. This is, by the way, already included in the open source project, and we will make more announcements about that and improve that all the time also. I mean, right now it's pretty similar, right? So it's more or less you can type in here, but you also have a few more commands, so you can do things easily. Some people like the web UI more than a command line interface. I'm one of these guys because I don't write code daily. So this helps me a lot to write and analyze code quickly, but you can choose whatever you want. And also very important, so I'm right now just using KSQL, but of course you can use any application in the same way. So in this case now, you see here a Kafka command. This is in the end the admin interface of Kafka. So here I ask them, for example, to list the topics from the command line. And all you do here, you can do the same things also from any API, like from Java or from .NET or from any connector then. And this is the things where you then produce messages and consume messages also in a similar way. So the first thing we now will do is we create a little bit test data. Because remember, Kafka typically is about events. It's an event-driven architecture. Even if you ingest it into Hadoop, where you do batch processing, or if you get it from a mainframe, in the middle it's all event-based. And that's a huge advantage because you can then do both real-time processing or near real-time, or you can aggregate it as batches again. So that's whatever you want to do. But with the decoupling in the middle in an event-based architecture, you can also leverage things like event sourcing concepts. That's also another thing we will hear in the second talk today by Guido a little bit more. What's the benefit of that and why so many use Kafka for these kind of new modern architectures then. So what I'm creating here is some test data. This is in the end just Hello World test data for clickstream analytics, where I have some users and I send simulate events of new clicks for the user. But this is in the real world, it's just bigger. It's just not a few messages, but it's for Netflix or LinkedIn, they have trillion of messages a day, right? So you can scale up to whatever you need with Kafka. But for Hello World, a few hundred messages are enough. And now you see again different ways to consume the data. How it would work, for example, from command line, or then also from a Java app, for example. Here on command line, I just use the Kafka consumer to read the data. The important thing is here now I have the end from the beginning. This means I really start from zero, right? Remember, Kafka is a distributed commit log. It starts from zero. It stores the data as long as you want. It's not a messaging system with a queue. In many use cases, you don't store it forever. These use cases exist and it's possible. But for example, for log analytics, you might store it for the last week to analyze the data. Or for bank transactions for 1 month, and then when everything is cleared, you can remove it. There's many different scenarios, and you can store it as long as you want, and then it automatically deletes the data you do not need anymore. You have things like you can say you only store the last 2 weeks, or you can say you only store the last 2 terabytes of data. Right? And so this is now the continuous flow you see. This is a process. This is not stopping. This is not a select query. This is continuously receiving new events. That's the main idea behind Kafka. It's an event-based architecture. And so it's running continuously until I stop it, which I will do now. And this was the command line interface. The same would happen in Java or in .NET if you programmatically do that in your application. And now we can also go back to KSQL to do some cool stuff. This is in the end, as I said, just another application on top of Kafka. In this case, we use KSQL to build some stream processing. So here we go back to the command line interface and create a stream. So here we define a stream based on an existing topic. So let me first do maybe again list topics. So now the test data I'm generating with the other scripts, it creates user data and page views. This is Kafka topics, where the data is sent in from, in this case, a test generator. In the real world, Twitter, social feed, sensor, any other legacy application, whatever feeds the data into Kafka. And now what I do, I create a stream on that data. I create a stream on that data. We can also list the streams, which we have. In this case, we only have this one. And now we can use the data. It's an incoming stream, and we can process or query that data here. So what we, for example, can do, we can select some data on this. Let's now switch to the web UI to show you the different component of that. But it's all connected to the same Kafka, so it doesn't matter, right? And here we write one select query. You could also do it here in this case. There are some templates which you can use if you do not know the language well in the beginning or if it's easier for you. In this case, I just do copy-paste. And I select the page ID and the user ID from the page views original stream. What's also important here, I define a limit of 10. Because what we actually want to build and deploy to production afterwards in a scalable mission-critical system is a continuous flow. So even these queries and streams and transformations we build here, they are deployed to run forever. Think about incoming system, and you want to transform data, for example, only filter non-important information. This is running continuously, right? So if you want to just read the data and analyze it here, then you have to limit it by 10 or by just control C and cancel it then. But the main idea is not to do interactive analysis, but really to deploy continuous streams which run 24/7 in a scalable system. Right here, I have just one instance running of Kafka Streams. The same would be true for a Kafka Streams application. And you can scale it up to whatever you need. You can scale off hundreds of Streams instances. And all the scalability and the failover and so on is handled by Kafka and Kafka Streams for you under the hood. So here you will see it will stop after 10 events here when they come. We can already continue to the next example here. And the next example is that we also create a table. As I said, what's also a very important concept if you build real-world applications in Kafka or in general in stream processing, if you can do that with the tooling, is that you have to manage state longer, and that's done with tables. So the basic concept is very similar to what you know from our Oracle database, but it's as in a streaming way. So here I create a streaming table based on a Kafka topic, and the key difference between the stream and the stream in the table is that the stream continuously processes every event by itself, and the table only updates the newest version, like you know it from an Oracle database. And so, let's see, for example, where do I have the select query? I have the select query here. Here now I select query from the database. This is only new data which I get here. That's very important, right? It's still a stream, but under the hood it's a state store. It's a table, so it only updates the new version. And in a case of a user management, for example, it makes sense. Think about this example. We have two events here which are coming in. The one is the stream of data. This is the click views. Every click is a single click. It's a new event. It's not related to another click. So you want to process every event on time. But on the other side, you have the users. The user has an address, a phone number, an email address. You don't want to process that all the time at the same thing. You want to keep the state in the stream process, but only once. And so you keep the state of the users, in this case, in a table, so that you can combine it and join it together with the stream of log analytics, of the stream of the click view in this case. And you can always, for every new click which is coming in, you combine it with the state of the user data to join it somehow. And on the other side, if then the user changes to a new email address, then you get another event to the user, which is updated there. So that's all happening continuously. And for the table, you only have the most updated version here. And in this way, you can do very smart things without adding another database. Because that, in many scenarios, it introduces a lot of problems. Because then you have, again, think about how do I get the data into the database and out of it? How do I use a cache? Or how do I interact with these systems? And so in some or many use cases around stream processing, you want to have the state in the stream, right, in the application here. And that's what's done pretty easily here. And it's good for many use cases, not for everyone. So for that, I think that's enough also regarding time. It's just important also to understand that what I'm really showing here is just some basic examples. You can do much more powerful things like aggregations and doing sliding windows or session windows and so on. You can do very powerful transformations. You can also build your own user-defined functions. So I have built an example where I really apply a machine learning model in one of these queries, right? I write a select query and then I use a user-defined function to apply an analytic model on top of that. So under the hood, it's just Java code, so you can embed anything there. I've built a few examples with different models like TensorFlow or H2O or Deep Learning 4J, and you can embed that easily into a Kafka Streams application or in the same by SKSQL. You just have to write this function once, and then you can embed that and use it from any SQL query where you have this library embedded here. And so it's pretty powerful and cool, and I think this is also easy to learn Apache Kafka, because with KSQL, even if you don't know much about the details, and often KSQL might not be the right solution because you have to code more complex things and use Java or the technology of your choice, but especially for the beginning, we have a few great tutorials how to get started in 10 minutes or so with that. And so that's, in the end, was the Kafka ecosystem, the open source ecosystem. So again, it's much more than streaming, as than messaging. It's a distributed messaging and storage in the middle with Kafka Connect and Kafka Streams. That's all the open source project Apache Kafka. Then we have open source components and the Apache license from Confluent, which are used in many, many projects. Because you see these requirements all the time, that's why we build it. Like a REST proxy, like a schema registry. Otherwise, you have to build it by yourself. And in most cases, it doesn't make sense because these are also battle-tested already. And if you need, you get commercial support, of course, also. But that's just optional. And then also Confluent Enterprise, of course, we built some enterprise toolings like end-to-end monitoring, which is a key challenge in Kafka, where you have distributed scalable messaging. And if you want to find out about lost messages or duplicates or latency, and you want to track down where the problem is, then that's pretty hard. And if you just build something with Grafana and JMX, that's not working. And that's what you will find out quickly. And so you have to build either your own solution or use a commercial tool for that, of course. And then also some other enterprise tools which help with operation, for example, for data balancing when you do read balancing between the brokers. But that's low-level details in the end then. And also, for example, a multi-data center replicator. If you want to replicate from one Kafka cluster to another, use cases here are disaster recovery or aggregation of different clusters. So it's different use cases which you can have there. So in the end, this is my final slide, just to summarize. Apache Kafka, that's really the rise of a streaming platform. So remember from this talk, Kafka is not just a messaging in the middle. It's not a queue. It's a distributed, scalable messaging and storage system. Yes, it's for high volume, so it's built for millions of messages. That's the first difference to queuing systems, where you can process hundreds or thousands of messages. But this kind of big data processing is not all the use cases. So 80% of use cases we see is about building mission-critical systems around Kafka ecosystem. And that's things like payments, like fraud detection, like customer 360 improvements, and all these things. So it's the normal projects which you have built with Java EE or so in the past, they are now built with Kafka in a streaming way and in an event-based-driven architecture with loosely coupled and independent microservices. So that's what I had. Thanks for coming. And I think we have a few minutes for questions, right? Okay, please. And we have also a microphone. So please wait for the microphone if you have any questions. You can also contact me afterwards via email and Twitter and so on, of course.
I just wonder about the tables. Where are they persisted?
The tables were from Kafka Streams and KSQL. They are persisted both in the local instance where the microservice is running. That means either in memory or on disk in RocksDB. In the instance where it's run, so each Kafka Streams or KSQL instance is a Java process which is running somewhere, right? Even if you have 100, then you have 100 processes, and everyone stores it either in memory where it is or on disk where it is. And in addition to that, it's also stored in Kafka topics because that makes the fault tolerance and so on. So if one of the 100 goes down, the state is not lost because it's also stored in Kafka topics in addition to that.
More questions?
There is one more in the back.
Hi, Alex from Digital Asset. Thank you very much for this talk. I was wondering, could you say a little bit about the limitations of Kafka as is? It sounds a little bit too good to be true,
yeah.
To be honest.
Yeah.
So where would you not use it, or what maybe?
Absolutely. Problem? And that's a very good question, because Kafka is not the silverware for everything. You cannot solve every problem with it. So first, what is true? Many use it as a central nervous system in the middle to integrate with anything. But there is something which is not, and which it does not try to do. So it is not a database. In terms of a database where you can search and do powerful search. So for that, if you want to search on things, you either use still a database like Cassandra, depending on the query you need, or something like Elasticsearch. So that's then one of the consumers of Kafka. So that's one of the important things, that it does not replace everything. And also on the other thing, it's not the best tool if you want to really do big data processing at once. So for something like Hadoop or Spark, where you process terabytes of data at once to find insights or so, then you push it into Spark. So it's not focused on every use case. So the key is it's the thing in the middle where you integrate everything easily for any scale, and any component can consume from it. And then you have to evaluate, do I need another component, or is Kafka enough? And that's the important thing. So for example, for stream processing, I'm not saying Kafka Streams is always the best solution. So it's one solution for stream processing. If you want to build light streaming applications independently of each other, for example, for microservice, then I'm 100% sure Kafka Streams is the best solution. On the other side, if you want to do terabyte processing at once, then Spark Streaming or Flink or so is the better solution. So I think these are the two things which you definitely cannot do. The one is the database and search replacement, and the other one is the big data MapReduce thing like of total reprocessing. Okay, then I think we are also at end of time. Thanks for coming. We also have another Kafka talk later by Guido Schmitz. He will talk more about, from another perspective, about the concepts like event sourcing and also like this thing with state stores, local instance and so on. So I also recommend that. It's simply another view on top of Kafka, more I think about the concepts and projects and so on. So thanks for coming.